Joining me now to talk about why this discovery is so important is James Branson, a physicist at UC San Diego and a researcher on the project for the last 20 years. And Jim, a lot of scientists are celebrating this discovery today because I believe it could tell us something more about how our universe works. But my question to you is, what does it mean to the folks at home who aren't scientists who say, we know it's a big deal, but we're not quite sure why?
Let me first say that it's not the easiest thing in the world to explain. It's pretty complicated, and there are a lot of reasons why it's interesting. But I would say one of the most important is that we've discovered really a new type of particle. We have what we call spin one particles, like the photon, and two beams of light, energy particles can go right through each other. And then we discovered matter particles like the electron and the proton, and we can't push our hand through the other hand because they can't be in the same place at the same time. It's called the Pauli exclusion principle, if you took
which
chemistry.
Is why we can't walk through a wall. Yeah. There's the actual physical.
And so those two things, energy particles and matter particles, are important. Now we have a third type, a spin zero particle, which is a particle that can change the vacuum. So basically the whole space-time vacuum changes when this Higgs phase transition happens and gives masses to all the particles. Before that, the particles were all zero mass like the photon. They were flying around at the speed of light, bouncing off each other a little bit, but you couldn't really coalesce anything. And then once the Higgs transition came, we got mass and we could make elements and chemicals and stars and things like that.
So the takeaway message is this is a new type, like an atom. This is a new type of particle that we thought existed, but there wasn't proof.
There was not any experimental evidence of it, but the only way we could justify what we call the weak interactions was to use this Higgs mechanism, which is a very strange mechanism, and it's kind of, you know, it's amazing that it came out to be correct, but all the measurements before said it was going to be.
And it was. So let's do this. I'm going to show some video here, and I want you to talk through. This is an animation that we're going to be looking at of what's happening inside the what's called the Super Collider over in Geneva that you've been working at. And what I want you to do is go ahead and explain to me what we're seeing. This is sort of the overview of when it starts, and then it'll start again. So what are we looking at right now?
Well, beams of protons are shot at each other in opposite directions, so we get the highest energy. And the protons inside those beams collide. And we get a lot of collisions per second. We take pictures of them every 50 nanoseconds with a 100 megapixel camera, effectively. And when those protons collide, a lot of other particles come out. So you see the protons coming together. You see a bunch of tracks coming out, and they give measurements in our 100 megapixel detector. And
that's what you're looking at,
yeah.
Right? That's what you're looking at. Now, you found you were at the collider in Geneva just until last night.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about what that building is like, what that research facility is like. And we have some video, actually, to show folks, so you can tell us what it's like there. How big is it? It's huge.
Well, it's a very large accelerator that's underground. Our experiment is about 160 meters underground. And the accelerator, I believe, is 26 kilometers in circumference. So it's underground, and it goes through two countries, Switzerland and France. And then our experiment is at one of the intersection points in that out in the countryside somewhere. But there are two main CERN campuses, one in Geneva and one in France, where there are offices. There are many, many buildings. There are thousands of people who work at CERN from all around the world.
It's huge. And I just want to stop you there because you're not the only scientist from San Diego who's been working on this. A couple of other guys, if you can tell me who they are, and then what this means to you and them.
So there are four of us who are on the faculty at UCSD, myself, Vivek Sharma, Avi Agil, and Frank Wertwein, and we're all working to some extent on the Higgs, but some of us work on supersymmetry also, but Vivek and myself work almost exclusively on the Higgs, and I've been working on this mode it's a strong mode where we've seen it recently. And of course, there are about 25 physicists from UCSD that are largely
fantastic.
Funded by the federal government, who are not funded, you know, through the university basically, but grants to the university, who are at UCSD and are at CERN. We're doing the analysis in both places, and we've made a lot of the intellectual inputs to this analysis, to the Higgs analysis, but in particular to the Higgs to photon analysis that we've been working on.
We love to hear about that. We don't have a whole lot of time, but have to bring this up. So the Higgs is called, nicknamed the God particle. Can you clear up why that is?
Well, I'm not happy that it's been nicknamed the God particle. Most of us aren't. But the reason for it is, Leon Lederman did this. He's a Nobel Prize winner for finding a much less interesting particle, but he's an important guy. But he wrote a book called The God Particle, because basically it changed the universe. The Big Bang came, we had all these massless particles, and then there was this phase transition where this Higgs field coalesced, made this background field that everything else has to plow through, and gave everything mass. So basically the character of the whole universe changed when this happened, and so that's why
they
might call it
that,
the God particle.
But it's just a nickname,
yes.
So we'll call it. James Branson from UCSD, physics professor, thank you so much for joining us
today.
It's
a pleasure.